Beacon Press Audio presents Blunt Instruments, Recognizing Racist Cultural Infrastructure in Memorials, Museums, and Patriotic Practices by Kristin Haas. This audiobook is narrated by Nadia Marshall. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2022. Introduction. White Lies Matter. In March 2021, a group of activists calling themselves White Lies Matter Incorporated stole a heavy stone chair from a cemetery in Selma, Alabama. It was a memorial to Jefferson Davis. The group emailed local media with ransom terms for the memorial's owners, the United Daughters of the Confederacy, UDC. They included photographs of a hole being cut into the seat, of a clever replica, of the chair, and promised to use it as a toilet unless the women of the UDC hung a banner on the front of their headquarters in Richmond, Virginia, quoting Asata Shakur, "The rulers of this country have always considered their property more important than our lives." The group asked for the banner to hang for 24 hours on Friday, April 9, 2021, the anniversary of the Confederacy's surrender in the Civil War. Unsurprisingly, the savvy UDC did not take the bait. See Figure 1. But White Lies Matter Incorporated was onto something, and the group's wit should not mask its cunning. Its name could hardly be smarter, and it captured something crucial about cultural infrastructure in the United States. The activists successfully called out the power of the ordinary. Memorials and parks, museums visited by school kids, and routine practices of patriotism, for instance, to naturalize simple untruths. In other words, White Lies Matter Incorporated helps us see, in a quick, vivid snapshot, that these lies are all around and that they really do matter. Jefferson Davis was the president of the Confederate States for the duration of the war. He was a man who said things like, "African slavery, as it exists in the United States, is a moral, a social, and a political blessing." And yet the plaque that stood beside the stolen memorial read, "He was the most honest, truest, gentlest, bravest, tenderest, manliest man." There is an undeniable contradiction between believing slavery to be a moral blessing and being the most honest, truest, gentlest, bravest, tenderest, manliest man, unless you believe in white supremacy. The lie that is implicit in this memorial and hundreds like it is that it is not an emblem of inequity or violence. The lie is that it is neutral heritage, something the UDC has maintained it can proudly protect in 2021 without being actively racist. The lie is that these memorials are innocent relics of the past. Pat Godwin, the president of the Selma chapter of the Daughters, claimed to be absolutely devastated by the theft, and in 2021, she had good reason to be worried. In the days and weeks after George Floyd was murdered on May 25, 2020, on the street in front of Cup Foods in Minneapolis, people across the United States and across the world took to the streets to protest. They chanted his name and called for an end to police brutality, and they toppled monuments and memorials. This may have seemed incongruous initially. By the end of the summer, more than 150 memorials had been knocked down by protesters or unceremoniously removed by municipal governments. Almost none of them were memorials to police officers. They were memorials and monuments of all kinds, mostly in the United States, but also in India, Colombia, South Africa, and the UK. In the United States, most were memorials that had stood quietly in local parks and on the grounds of government buildings for at least a century, and most were memorials to Confederate soldiers or Christopher Columbus. They had stood mute, but it seemed to become clear, quite suddenly, that they had been doing the serious cultural work of maintaining racial hierarchies. The protesters tore them down in an effort to reject these everyday affirmations of profound inequities. And while there is plenty of room for subtlety and nuance in understanding and representing even the most fraught heritage, most cultural infrastructure is like the Davis chair, not made for the expression of subtlety or nuance. Like the White Lies Matter folks, the protesters pulling down monuments were refusing to tolerate lies embedded in the landscape. They were right that these monuments are an important part of the cultural infrastructure, a system of meaning-making that enabled a brutal murder, which took more than 9 minutes and was witnessed by as many as 1 billion people, to be committed by one police officer in front of 3 others. But these monuments and the thousands that still stand across the United States are only one part of the cultural infrastructure, the blunt instruments, that work to maintain basic untruths about race. For instance, that white people are better, more worthy, matter more than black and brown people. Blunt Instruments is a field guide of sorts to racist cultural infrastructure in the United States. It is intended to be a tool to help readers identify, contextualize, and name elements of our everyday landscapes and cultural practices that are designed to seem benign or natural, but that, in fact, work tirelessly to tell vital stories about who we are, how we came to be, and who belongs. These are stories about who has power in the culture and who doesn't. They are also almost always stories about race. Blunt Instruments looks at 3 categories of cultural infrastructure: memorials, museums, and everyday patriotic practices. Each of these has been very much in the news for most of the 21st century. In fact, more intense, riotous, fraught attention has been paid to them in the last 20 years than in most of the first 200 years of American life. And yet they are seldom looked at together or understood explicitly as tools used by particular people in particular times and places to shape the culture in particular ways. This book responds to this gap. Understanding what cultural infrastructure is and the deep and broad impact that it has is crucial to understanding how structures of inequity are maintained and how they might be dismantled. This book is shaped by a few basic observations. The first is that it takes a tremendous amount of work to make fictional ideas about race seem natural. For instance, the bold, insistent assertion that Confederate soldiers gave their lives to preserve an innocent, race-neutral American heritage. The second is that cultural infrastructures are powerful tools. The same people who describe monuments as benign or neutral will go to extraordinary lengths to prevent their removal. The third is that all infrastructure is cultural. It is always shaped by the values of the culture. The fourth observation builds on these. It is that we are surrounded by cultural objects that don't necessarily seem to have anything to do with culture or values or ideology, like a science museum, but that work every day to tell us who we are. And crucially, that much of this telling, in the obviously cultural infrastructure and the less obviously cultural infrastructure, has been about racial hierarchies and has been effective in maintaining structures of inequity. This short book does not try to be a comprehensive guide to all cultural infrastructure or to engage with every contemporary debate. Instead, it offers a brief history of 3 forms of cultural infrastructure: memorials, museums, and everyday patriotic practices, and close readings of a few particularly important examples of each to make it easy for readers to understand the cultural infrastructure they encounter in their daily lives. Starting with Colin Kaepernick. It began in the preseason and was, initially, such a modest gesture that it went largely unnoticed. San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick was not in uniform for the first game the team played. He was sitting on the bench, and when the national anthem was played on August 14, 2016, he stayed seated. 4 years earlier, in 2012, teenage Trayvon Martin was murdered in Florida because he seemed threatening to the man who killed him with impunity. In 2014, 18-year-old Michael Brown Jr., who was unarmed, was murdered in broad daylight in front of witnesses. His hands were raised above his head, and he was saying, "Don't shoot." A few months later, Eric Garner was murdered in Staten Island in front of a crowd of witnesses. He told the police officer who had him in a chokehold, "I can't breathe," 11 times before he died. Garner's murder, like George Floyd's, was witnessed by millions of people across the United States and around the world who watched a video of the murder that was recorded as it was happening. His death was determined to be a homicide, but the officer who killed him was not indicted. The Black Lives Matter movement emerged, led by Alicia Garza, Patrice Kilors, and Opal Tometi, and then exploded. Murders like this were not new in 2012, or 2014, or 2016. They are one of the worst examples in U.S. culture of basic, everyday lies about race that we all live with.
We are surrounded by. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.